What's up, y'all? I am Marcus. Welcome back to Yharnam FM. I'll be your hunter today. Today, we're going to get a couple of cool little dialogues here with Mr. Gilbert before we get started. Gilbert is... before, he was feeling really resigned to his fate. He was like, well, at least I could die a human, so that's good. But it seems like he may have changed his tune just a little bit. So let's warp into Central Yharnam and see what he has to say. What's up, Gilbert? How you doing, bro?
Have I heard of Bergenworth? Afraid I can't say that I have. The locals aren't apt to share any local history. I'm afraid I may not be of help for much longer.
Interesting.
And I'm afraid I may not be of help for much longer.
Bergenworth, knowledge about that is something that Alfred very, very freely shared with us, but Gilbert is saying the locals don't really talk about local history too much. What else you think, Gilbert? We see Gilbert has changed his tune. He has taken a sudden turn for the worse. Really curious what's eating Gilbert Grape there, but and he basically sounds right now the way I feel. I apologize for this video being late. I apologize for my crappy sounding voice. I apologize for the post commentary. But I am sick, so it happens, guys. It happens even if you make YouTube videos, maybe even especially. But this area, oh man. The Forbidden Graves is the place we warped to. And hello. You'll immediately notice all of the fucking eyes on this motherfucker right here. And he does look humanoid in shape. It really kind of looks transformed. He's got something he's clutching in his left hand. I'm not exactly sure what that is supposed to be. Like a Behelit from Berserk, maybe. But the main point here is all these eyes, and actually the official name for this enemy, which I cannot reveal, I'm sorry, but once it's revealed, it actually has some lore for it. But the key point is definitely the eyes. The eyes, man. And here we go into Bergenworth. This area's atmosphere, I like this. I like this a lot. The area overall is super short and kind of a serious disappointment to be such a important place in the lore. It's just tiny, 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 tiny. And there's only a couple of different types of enemies. And so that's kind of a disappointment. But the atmosphere and the way that it looks is definitely not a disappointment at all. Now, if you got any sedatives, you might want to go ahead and equip them. These eyeball dudes, they can cause frenzy. And what frenzy does is once it builds up all the way, you lose a chunk of health. Similar to bleed from Dark Souls 1. But it's really annoying because the frenzy buildup is very jittery. And you'll see, without spoiling too much for you here in the video, I will get caught by an attack called this frenzy. Even after you remove the exposure to whatever was causing frenzy, the bar still builds up a little bit. It's super annoying. But if you're quick, you can often save yourself with a sedative. However, a lot of the attacks in the game that can cause frenzy are grab attacks that do damage. And so if you don't have a certain amount of frenzy resistance in the first place, you just die. Those attacks become one-hit kills, and I personally find that to be completely annoying. They feel like cheap deaths to me, which is something that there's not a whole lot of deaths that feel to me like cheap deaths. Here, I can't take the high ground. You can see one of those guys walking off over there. I'm just gonna shoot at this guy, get his attention, and despite having wings and the ability to fly, he cannot seem to make it. He just can't make it. It's cool with me, though. I do love the atmosphere, though. Like, I'm really torn. Those crazy statues. For dealing with these guys with the rifle spear, just stepping back and dodging attack and then hitting at R2 has plenty of range. It reaches, it does counter damage. It's really good. When I came through on my arcane character, I was doing jumping attacks with Ludwig's Holy Blade to do the same thing. And I think, I can't remember if it was Strongbad, one of my characters came through here with a Kirk Hammer and just like mashed R1 on them. These guys, still nasty. Don't want to get paralyzed by that. Oh man. I really hate these guys. I really hate these guys. But they're not the worst enemies in the game. And especially at this point, I've got enough vitality that they're not gonna kill me. Here you go. I'm like, huh. This is gonna be some of the worst play you've seen from me yet. I'm sorry. I was feeling like shit and it just was not good. It was not good. That's also the reason there's post commentary in case you're curious. Boop 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 boop. Arcane Lake. Notice this has 7% arcane damage reduction, whereas some of the previous runes had 3%. And I don't know if I've actually talked about this in the playthrough yet. There are actually levels of these runes. You guys who are playing the game probably already realize this, but for those of you who haven't, my PC bros, there's actually levels of runes, and so you have some character progression collecting the additional levels of the runes. That sick atmosphere, though, man. That moon. Now here, the tactic, if you look up above, you're gonna see these guys hop down. And they kind of tend to come together instead of one by one. They tend to pull together. Now, what I wanted to do was just kind of keep backing up along the pathway. But you see, it's a bit of a winding path. And I screwed up right there. See, I went left a little bit instead of going down the stairs. This could have easily been a death. I'm getting frenzied right now. But I managed to roll out of there. Notice the frenzy continues to go up even though the attack is gone. Heal it up. And I got grabbed again. I should have cured my frenzy. But here, I actually, if I'm really quick, sedative. Whew, that was close. It would not have actually killed me because it takes a large percentage, but it takes a percentage of your maximum health. And since I was at full health, it wouldn't have actually killed me. But yeah, there are grab attacks that do damage and cause frenzy, and those are the ones that I'm talking about. Can be an instant death if you're not real careful. Sedatives are really, really nice to have around here, and you just gotta be quick to use them. So that didn't go real clean, but they're dead. All right, now up ahead, there's one of these giant flower monster dudes. Shoot these kind of, that's very reminiscent of the armored spider from Demon Souls, those fireballs that it shoots. But you'll notice that I'm aiming high. I'm aiming at the top of the flower on its head. That takes a lot more damage than the body. And so just a few shots and you can kill it. Oops. Unless it breaks your lock on by moving behind something. All right, mission success. And here we get our first Great One's wisdom. This is an upgraded version of the Madman's wisdom. Fragments of the lost wisdom of the Great Ones, beings that might be described as gods. At Bergenworth, Master Willem had an epiphany. We are thinking on the basest of planes. What we need are more eyes. And once again, we've seen from this, eyes on the inside, although no one truly remembers what that entails. So this is kind of further evidence. Now, it's not, like many things in Souls games, it's not super 100%, oh, and inside is literally eyes inside your head. But it is hinted that that could be the case, and especially with the mutations of humans that are obviously going on in this game, it's not such a far-fetched thing for people to actually be putting eyes inside their brain. And later descriptions are going to provide even more support for this idea, but to me, this insight, it really represents insanity. Although, I mean, who's to say that insanity is a bad thing? Like, maybe insanity is really the knowledge of the gods, man. Who knows? Love it. And this is the place where it all started. Well, kind of. This is actually not the place where it all started. This is the place where people rediscovered what was going on. And we already know that because it was scholars from Bergenworth, young scholars from Bergenworth, descended into the labyrinth and found a holy medium, the relics, the leftover relics of the gods, right? This NPC hunter that comes down the stairs, she gives a lot of people trouble. That move right there can hit pretty hard. It's always try to have some cover. And for me in this case, she wasn't really that bad because we can outrange her. Normally threaded cane's got pretty good range, but because we're using a rifle spear, we can actually outrange her. And she doesn't do that much damage overall, especially if you have good vit, you're using a physical defense rune, stuff like that. And the rifle spear's one-handed mode is actually faster than the threaded cane's transform mode. So I'm maybe having an easier time with her than some people might. It really depends on your weapon. That said, my Ludwig's Holy Blade jumping attack, once again, had plenty of range, so yeah, gotta be careful when she uses that, though, because it can hit very hard. But her armor has a lot of gameplay significance. She is using the set of the choir, and it's something that we'll just have to talk about once we get to that part of the game. And we're getting near the end, though, guys, so the answers are about to start coming, because after this we have, let's see, two more main areas that we have to do, and I think three optional areas. So not quite the final third of the game, but we're getting very close. And we will be learning more about the choir. Once she goes into the threaded cane mode, or the staff mode, spamming these attacks, it's pretty easy to get a parry, although it took me a while. So yeah, I've heard a lot of people having trouble with her. Just remember to open that door on the other side so that you can move the battle around as convenient for you, so that you have places where you can hide from her magic attacks, and that's going to make things easier. And trying to attack from outside of her range can work, or if you have an extremely fast weapon, then you can just get in her face and keep wailing on her. Either way, man, it's up to you what you want to do. It's up to you what you want to do. It's the great thing about it. People always complain about how I play these games. I'm like, hey man, there's a bunch of different ways you can play these. It's all good. Like, it's all good. Tons of legit ways to play. And here we got our student uniform. Great. Gonna go to school. Where they at? There they are. Uniform of students at Bergenworth, a bygone institute of learning. The Healing Church had its roots at Bergenworth, and naturally borrows heavily from its uniform design. The focus not on knowledge or thought, but on pure pretension, would surely bring Master Willem to despair if he only knew. So, Master Willem is not in any sort of condition at this point to know about this pure pretension. But it's interesting to me. I think that my take on this is that when Lawrence left to found the Healing Church, once again, this is my opinion. You see my blood bandito. I think that Lawrence left to found the Healing Church. And at first, they were really just trying to use these relics that they found in the underground labyrinths to heal people. To heal people's sickness. Stuff like the Ashen Blood. That he was trying to help people. And they wanted to research more about these gods and about the ways they can use the blood. Oh, note. When the red moon hangs low, the line between man and beast is blurred. And when the great ones descend, a womb will be blessed with child. Going back to what we just learned from Mentis, we know that newborns are being used to lure the great ones in a ritual. And we talked about this pale blood sky, and now they're talking about the red moon hanging low. So it seems like there is a ritual being conducted to have a liaison between a great one and a human female to have kind of an interbred child be born here. Key to the lunarium facing the lake on the second floor. In his final years, Master Willem was fond of the lookout and the rocking chair that he kept there for meditation. In the end, it is said, he left his secret with the lake. Yeah, so everything is kind of starting to come together. And like I was saying about Lawrence, I think he maybe had good intentions. But over time, the Healing Church has been perverted in a sense. Like it's lost its original purpose, or maybe its purpose has changed over time, and that is what would drive Master Willem absolutely insane. He didn't approve of what Lawrence was doing, but at the same time, I didn't really get the impression that he was angry at Lawrence or anything like that. He was more worried about him. Here we got a new item, though. Empty invertebrate shell that is said to be a familiar of a great one. The Healing Church has discovered a great variety of invertebrates, or phantasms as they are called. Shells with slime still harbor arcane power and can be rubbed on weapons to imbue them with their strength. This is a really interesting arcane item. You have to have 15 arcane to use it. It costs 3 bullets, 3 quicksilver bullets to use. It receives no attribute bonus, but this can only be used on buffable weapons. And if you put an elemental gem in a weapon, then it can't be buffed. So that's a really weird, really weird spell. Like, it fits into the game in a very odd way. I would say it's not really for pure arcane builds. It's for mainly skill builds with 15 arcane, but a strength build with 15 arcane could use it. But I would say it kind of a hybrid builds item. And here's the Lunarium, and here is the man himself, Master Willem. We have been looking for you, dude. Can we get some story? Can I get some story? What you pointing at, bro? You gotta talk to me, Willem. You want me to look over here? I see the moon, Willem. It's very pretty. I see the lake. It's very nice. Oh, by the way, this basically is the confirmation that it's a lake in the previous episodes. So, I see the moon, man. What do you want me to do with the moon? What do you want me to do, Willem? I don't get it. This is one of the nastiest parts of the game, by far. Just like, not nasty as in disgusting, but kind of really tricky. Willem! Well, talk to me, motherfucker! Talk to me, motherfucker! Tell me the truth. Speak, Willem. It'll all be over. I'll grant you a merciful death. Just please. Oh, no, I killed him. You don't have to kill Willem. But if you kill Willem, you get this. Ooh, the eye rune. I wanted the lore. I'm sorry, I did it for the lore. A transcription of I, as spoken by Left Behind Great Ones, allows to make additional discoveries. Eyes symbolize the truth Master Willem sought in his research. Disillusioned by the limits of human intellect, Master Willem looked to beings from higher planes for guidance and sought to line his brain with eyes in order to elevate his thoughts. That also greatly increases your discovery, good for long chalice runs if you're using the cannon or lots of spells and stuff. So, I guess I'll catch you guys on the next Yharnam film, because we don't know what to do. Oh no. Just playing. Just playing. Here you actually have to jump into the lake. It's kind of nasty. It's kind of a nasty little trick. And down here, this is definitely one of the more bizarre parts of the game. The Moonside Lake. Well, hi. You couldn't possibly be a boss. You seem very friendly. Got pretty stuff growing on you. Oh my, and look at all of your eyes and your very creepy mouth. Can actually see inside a little bit there. This boss is Rom the Vacuous Spider. Now, I am going to show you absolutely the worst way to do this fight. I'm sorry, I didn't feel good, I just was not playing properly. What you want to do is each time spiders, little spiders spawn, just kill them. That's one strategy. And if you kill the little spiders each time they spawn, then they don't get out of hand. Another way to do it is to completely ignore the little spiders and just fight Rom. And if you have a really high damage weapon, like if you're using a build with Tinnitus or something, which is what my arcane character did, you can go to town. But I didn't do that. I kind of did a stupid ass hybrid strategy where I didn't kill the spiders immediately, but I did kill a lot of them in the end. It was really dumb. This, do not do the fight like you're watching me do it at all. Also take note that his head and the heads of the spiders are protected, so you can't do much damage to them. Instead, you need to hit their bodies. This is very much like the Phalanx fight from Demon Souls, except a lot more annoying, because Rom has these magic attacks that can mess you up. If you stay in kind of this medium range, you can bait this attack where these crystals come from below the lake. That's by far the easiest one to dodge, and that's the one that I prefer to face. You see, Rom, I keep saying he, it's actually she, Rom now has this army of spiders at her disposal, which is stupid. I should never have let this happen, but I did. I did it anyway. Now. Now this attack, there's going to be ice crystals coming from the sky. I couldn't get my camera up enough to see it, but you can actually turn your camera up if you're not locked on. You can turn your camera up into the sky and see the crystals coming down so that you can dodge them. This is crystals from the lake, that rolling over on the back bit there. Here I'm like, well, fuck, I might actually have to kill some of these spiders. And now we're gonna look up and try to dodge. There's not necessarily one direction that you can run in that will always allow you to dodge to dodge those crystals. Oftentimes running forward and to the left will work, but it's not a complete guarantee. Like, it is possible to get hit. And now that we're in this third phase, Rom will actually melee as well. So I've really just kind of fucked myself, no matter how you want to look at it. And I'm realizing that at this point too. I'm like, oh my god, what have I done? What did I do? So, if you want to do it the easy way, kill the spiders before, each time they spawn, kill the spiders before continuing to do damage to Rom. If you want to do it the quick way, completely ignore the spiders and just hit Rom. If you want to do it the stupid-ass fucking hard way, don't kill the spiders, let Rom spawn them all, and then be like, oh, let me kill the spiders. That's the dumb way to do the fight, once again. Maybe I should tag my arcane kill on the end of this video to let you guys see how that goes. Although it's a little bit of a... I gotta say, it's a little bit of a YOLO, because ROM can kill you. Like, it's... When you just go in, damage, it is possible to just do so much damage that ROM dies very, very quickly. Even with just like a plus 6 to nitrous, it can really destroy ROM. But on the other hand, it is also very possible for the spiders to get you, and you get unlucky, and then you're just dead. As for the lore on ROM, which is, I guess, what a lot of people are going to be more interested in, it's a little bit confusing, but ROM is kin, and we're going to see this explained from an item dropped from ROM, but ROM is kin, which means not a great one, not a human, kin of the great ones, so similar to a great one, but not a true great one. And that's actually, we know this from the blood that ROM drops. She is kin. And going back all the way to like the second or third episode, we found a note, remember, in Uden Chapel that said the Bergenworth spider hides all sorts of rituals and something about the Lost Master. The Lost Master obviously being Willem. Well, I say obviously being Willem. It could also be Lawrence, but I suspect it's Willem. But hiding all sorts of rituals. And this is the part that's really kind of difficult to get, to be honest. Whoop. I got pegged again. Whew. I'm having to heal a little bit less there because I'm down to 2 blood vials. I haven't really done damage to ROM in a while. But you can tell how much easier this would have been if I had just killed the spiders from the start. You do it from the start and ROM's not as aggressive and there's not as many spiders to attack you. Oh, them crystals. Oh, I almost died. That was so close. Alright, we're out of blood vials. Ladies and gentlemen, we gotta get the kill right now. If we're gonna kill this boss, we have got to get the kill right now. We cannot afford to fuck around with spiders anymore. We have thinned them out a little bit. So, oh, and I got hit by the AoE. Whenever ROM rolls over on her back real close like that, there's a good chance you kind of need to get out of dodge, because there's a good chance it's going to be that AoE, which means area of effect, for those of you who don't know AoE. I actually get comments like that. I know people out there like, oh, who doesn't know AoE? Oh my god, we're almost dead. This is it. We're not going to make it. We're not going to make it. The dream was real. The dream is dead. There's no chance, right? There's no way we could possibly survive. I don't want to back far enough away for him to use ice crystals again from the sky, because if he does, oh man, we are in trouble. It's a crapshoot. Hey, we killed it. Oh. Ken Coldblood, you died. Guess what though? It motherfucking counts. And here's the Ken Coldblood that confirms that on ROM. Coldblood of the inhuman kin of the cosmos, brethren of the great ones. Dare not to delve into the world beyond humanity, the eldritch truth touched upon long ago at Bergenworth. I wonder about ROM's story. I wonder if she was a student at Bergenworth. Or, I don't know. Really interesting. I want to know more about ROM, but there's a limited amount of information in the game, unfortunately. Let those guys jump off. And right back down below, you can see the water glows. There's a fog gate down there. Alright, so there's a creepy looking woman. We want to go talk to the creepy looking woman, but first, I'd like to find my blood echoes, which is proving to be a wee bit difficult. I'm like, okay, And fortunately, I did spot them. As I was about to say fuck it, I did spot them. Because we're actually going to use these. We actually need these at this point. Now, the story of the game starts to become slightly more confusing, but slightly more clear as well in this cutscene. And then we wake up in Cathedral Ward. Ritual secret broken. Seek the nightmare newborn. And we have this big ugly motherfucker staring us down right here. It's pretty bizarre. You can come here earlier in the game and this is kind of... You can't really proceed. Although if you have the tonsil stone, you can actually let that guy grab you and go to an optional area that we are still going to do. We're just going to do it a little bit later. And you see, this is actually the entrance to Yar-Hogul. So this is the second trip to Yar-Hogul. The first time when you're kidnapped, it's not quite like this. Now the sky's all crazy and we're coming in from a different direction. And oh man, that is the pale blood sky right there. That is pale blood. That is what we are seeking. So from the very beginning of the game, what we were supposed to seek, we were supposed to seek pale blood. Not necessarily blood per se. We were supposed to seek this ritual, because this ritual is what is causing these events to happen. So if we want to stop the hunt and stop the dream, we have got to seek pale blood. We have got to stop the ritual. Stopping the ritual will stop the dream. Or at least that's one way we can look at it. And you can see the entire hunter's dream has changed, and we have some stuff. Talk to us, Dolly. What do you have to say?
Welcome home, good hunter. What is it you desire? Good hunter, your presence somehow soothes. I sense the ancient echoes. They course your veins. Good hunter, very well. Let the echoes become yours.
The ancient echoes, I just leveled up, is all I did. And when I went back to Central Yharnam, we got this beast guy here. And of course, gonna go ahead and kill him. Claw mark? The fuck? Gilbert, oh no. So, it looks like that was Gilbert. It looks like he transformed and busted his way out of there. Possible that the guy went in after him, but pretty unlikely. And we get the claw mark rune. The claw mark is an impulse to seek the warmth of blood like a beast. It strengthens visceral attacks, one of the darker hunter techniques. Although the difference is subtle, Runesmith Carroll describes the beast as a horrific and unwelcome instinct deep within the hearts of men, while Clawmark is an alluring invitation to accept this very nature. So the Clawmark rune is an invitation to give in to the beast within. And we already know that when the red moon hangs low, the difference between man and beast is lessened. We learned that from the note at Bergenworth. And if you go around and you start trying to check these NPCs, you're gonna get a lot of no responses, you're gonna get some crazy folks, and you're gonna get this.
You haven't by any chance seen my little sister, have you? I told her to look after the house, but she's run off somewhere. She's still quite small, and wears a big white ribbon. Have you seen her out there anywhere? Oh, how did this happen? Why would she ever go outside? At least, I'll have something to remember her by. a perfect ribbon. And now it's mine. I can't wait to try it on. Oh, it's wonderful.